Good evening, friends. Warm welcome to all of you in this webinar, very interesting webinar, impact of COVID-19 on banking and finance sector by our renowned faculty, CA Vaibhav Jain, director at capital firm. I would like to say request Abhishek to say a few words, address the audience.
Thank you, Virak. First of all, welcome Manoj bhai, Vibhav ji, and our JCF Navi Mumbai chapter president, CA Tarachand Bapna sir. As you all knows, guys, we are doing this activity only for knowledge sharing and to add values in our fellow members of the professions. So as of now, we have connected around 15,000 plus professional through our social media network. So our main motto of network is to just to do some kind of value addition in our members. There is nothing any other motive behind this network. And we have connected through Telegram, WhatsApp, Facebook, and various social media channels. So I request all the members to please connect to our Telegram group as well as Facebook group. So now I request Virak to please proceed further.
Manoj ji, please take the charge.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Virak, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to host this seminar, Impact of COVID-19 on Banking and Finance Sector. So I would also welcome Mr. Tarachand ji Bapna sir and Mr. Vaibhav Jain sir. Guys, and see, nowadays we are hearing all in the news and media COVID-19, it's becoming villain of the town nowadays. The speed of its spread is increasing alarmingly, day by day across the globe. It's US, it's Spain, Germany, France, Italy, and India is not left from that. So friends, this COVID-19 has altogether impacted the entire economy very badly, and it's a result of disruption of entire ecosystem, entire demand supply gap, the consumer behavior, consumer pattern, consumption pattern, all the logistic transportation and economic activities across the globe, and India is also not left from there. As far as India is concerned, in pursuance of its density and population, we have, fought a very good battle from COVID-19. And compared to other countries, we have very less number of corona patients. But still, the fight is on, and it's not at less justifiable level. It's almost it's crossed 30,000 plus, and death toll crossed 900. However, government is implementing a lot much preventive measures for implementing this for the purpose of containment and prevention of this COVID-19, and lockdown is one of the. But due to lockdown, lot of effect has already been come on economy. It has totally it's seen to be proven as lackluster note for the economy across the globe as well as India for the longer term. So now I will definitely come on the impact on means how we are going to discuss the impact. But due to this lockdown, entire economy has been is come on standstill mode, means all the consumption stopped, demand stopped, entire ecosystem, business channel, everything is being stopped. There are some words of sorrows like job threats, lack of salary, NBFC collapse, MSME collapse, some redemption pressures, everything is there. But I am not going to discuss all the things. I am not going into the numbers of this because I am sure our speaker is going to the deep depth of this whenever it relevance to us. So guys, with all these things, I would also like to emphasize on the silver lining on the government's and RBI's measures to prevent this economic hazards because of this impact of because of the impact of this COVID-19. Now the thing is, however, RBI is implementing too much good pressure, like reduction in CRR, SLRs, reduction in MSF, extending moratorium period, which is giving good financial boost for our economy. But are these relief measures are enough? Are these things are enough to prevent the turbulences which has been occurred because of this COVID-19? That's a major question. How are our economy is going to respond? How the consumption pattern, how the production, how the supply chain management, entire ecosystem of the business activity is going to respond this COVID-19 impact? That's a major question. And we are here to have a detailed discussion of impact of COVID-19 on banking, economy and finance sector. So Mr. Vaibhav Jain, he's definitely going to discuss all this thing in detail. I would like to introduce Mr. Vaibhav Jain as well. So Mr. Vaibhav Jain, our friend, fellow chartered accountant, he's a finance expert with massive experience in corporate finance, debt syndication, capital restructuring for SMEs, MSMEs. He has worked on the senior position of some of the leading NBFCs and some banking segment as well. Vaibhav, in past, he has worked as a president of Ashika Capital, where he has set up the entire corporate lending business and debt syndication. And now he is running his own show. He is pretty much expert, experienced expert, and carrying a lot of rich experience in debt syndication and this restructuring. So with this, I would like to pass the screen on to Mr. Vaibhav Jain, who is going to showcase us how this COVID-19 has impacted our economy and how it has impacted our banking and finance sector, and how difficult it would be for us to raise finance from banking and NBFC sector, lending institutions down the line. See, our webinar is aimed to have a detailed discussion on impact on banking and finance sector as well. How the bankers' mindsets are also down the line is going to get changed. How the banks are going to strengthen their credit policy. Whether it would be easy for all the industry to raise finance or it would be difficult for the negative industries. So entire things we are going to discuss. So I would would like to tell all the attendees, it's going to be a very interactive as well as interesting session. The entire session is going to be segregated in three parts. In first part, Vaibhav is going to have a detailed discussion on impact of COVID-19 on banking sector and economy. On second part, we are going to have a detailed discussion on how it has impacted as far as fundraising is concerned, how it has impacted this financial requirement part, how the bankers are going to deal with this sector. Are they going to strict or they're going to flexible? On the third part, we are going to have a question and answer session. I would like to tell all the attendees, there's a Q&A template in your screen, so you can post any of your question after completion of second session on your Q&A templates. We would try to answer the questions as maximum as possible. So I would pick up the questions and Vaibhav will try to answer them. So Vaibhav, the screen is yours. You can take the control of this screen and just bataiye hamari janta ko ki कैसे इम्पैक्ट करने वाला है और क्या होने वाला है. सब जने जो इतना परेशान है, थोड़ा जो डर फैला हुआ है, उस डर की क्या दवाई है. तो वैभव, आई वुड लाइक टू पास द स्क्रीन.
मनोज, वार्म वेलकम टू यू. अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल द फेलो अटेंडीज अलोंग विद द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स इंक्लूडिंग विरांग एंड द जीसीएफ टीम एंड अभिषेक एंड ऑल द सीनियर गाइस हु आर देयर ऑन द बोर्ड विद अस. इट्स अ मीनिंगफुल सेशन बिकॉज दिस इज वन सेशन वेयर वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट बिजनेस अपॉर्चुनिटी, where we will be thinking as a chartered accountants, is there more work which we can cater? What is going to be the treatment which we will going to have in the market? How we will be deciding our future course of action for our various clients for which we are working across the globe? Taking across this presentation, my first haircut is I'm taking across a small presentation. So you would have seen a screen. I believe the screen would be visible to each and every one of you. We are just running a small presentation wherein we will be sharing the basic effect which has come out because of this COVID-19, and then we will be talking about few industry, and then we will be taking across the banking and the finance possibility under COVID. So taking a clue from this, let's first understand what is coronavirus. So coronavirus, when we were sitting somewhere in January and February in our own offices, you know, we were all understanding that something is happening in China and then it might spread somewhere. But within our own comfort, we were all contemplating that, no, it can never come to Indian soil. There were few assumptions which we will be having. We were thinking that the post-March, there will be a lot of heat and there will be a rise in temperature and the virus will not sustain. But then now we are sitting almost at the end of April. So this virus is ever changing. The effect which it has created is massive. So just to give a brief, this is already spread across 210 countries and almost 3 million people worldwide have got impacted because of it. In India, the number is touched close to 30,000 and there is a death toll which is almost 939. Now this seems to be scary across the globe when we see positions of European country and when we see figures of United States, which is one of the most developed country, we see India in safe hands because of whatever the leadership call which has been taken. But at the same time, we are running in an era where we are under lockdown. So the government of India has imposed a lockdown almost by second week or third week of March, 21st, 22nd March. And from that onwards till this April, till 3rd May, the lockdown is already announced. And we are talking about the impact of coronavirus on Indian economy. There are various agencies which has different views about the coronavirus impact. So when we talk to Dun and Bradstreet, they say that the extent is very, very severe and this can impact the industry across the globe. When we talk to FICCI, which is the trade association in India, they said that there is a tremendous uncertainty about the future of the industries which are working across the country. CRISIL, which is one of our leading rating agency, which is part of Standards and Poor's, who has estimated a growth estimate of GDP in India to almost 6% way back, has already reduced this GDP estimate in March to 3.5%, is further reducing the GDP estimate to 1.8%. When we look to some figures which has been incorporated from KPMG, we see the GDP, which was almost in the range of 6.5 to 7.5. till almost 2-3 running years, is continuously coming down. So 1920 itself was not really a great year, but still we were having GDP. We were thinking that for financial year 2021, the initial GDP assumptions were to the range of 6%, which now as per the rating estimates could be in range of anything around 2-2.5%. COVID-19 impact, which is considered to be a national emergency by WHO, you know, it has impacted the entire world. Now, the outcome which has started, it has started primarily from the country, which is China, which is considered as the second largest importer in the world. So almost for the entire world, 13% of exports comes from China and entire world have 11% of world imports comes from China. So even when we study about India, out of the top 20 products which we import as per the HS code of India, we have got maximum share of imports coming in from China. Just to give a basic numbers, like India's total electronic imports account for 45% of China, around 1/3 of machinery and almost 2/5 of organic chemical that India purchases from the world come from China. Automotive parts and fertilizers, China's share in India's import is more than 25%, around 65 to 70% of APIs and around 90% of certain mobile accessories comes from China. So, you know, the impact which has started somewhere from January, February, the first concern was the supply side, which we always thought that since we are importing such a huge quantity from China, there will be a tremendous effect on the companies or the industries which have import or maybe the raw material products coming from China. But by that time, honestly, when we were talking to bankers and all the people, we were all contemplating the fact that the effect will be limited to those companies which have some kind of products getting imported or raw material component which is coming from China. That time we were not even thinking and bothering about that this will affect the supply, the manufacturing, the production and all necessary elements of our country also. If we go sector by sector impact, so you know, there is no sector which is left out because of this coronavirus impact. So the effect could be higher or the effect could be lower. But if we say that this particular industry is not impacted, it will going to be a lie. So running from airlines and hotels, so this is a study which is done by McKinsey. As per McKinsey's study, if we go sector-wise, airlines and hotels would have a severe impact in terms of their business to the extent of 70 to 75%. Now, airlines and hotels account to close to 2% of our GDP share. In terms of manpower, the kind of manpower which they employ is close to 4 million odd people across the country, which is there in the direct job. And then there is a lot of indirect job people also. If we talk about auto and advanced industry, the impact could be 50 to 60%. Construction real estate, which is already running to one of the most, you can say, setback kind of period, is again going to be one of the most severe impacted industry. And the impact could be in the range of 50 to 60%. Moving from textiles, freights and logistics, metals and mining, oil and gas, power, consumer and retail, I don't suppose there is any industry which will going to have a lower impact, but the impact will be very severe to the range of 20% to 50% kind of scenario. However, there are few industries where the impact could be lower or impact could be pretty low in terms of the overall scale is concerned. We can always have some kind of green shoe opportunity that for these industry, there can be a possibility of better businesses also. But then because of the constraints, which as in lockdown, because that's one of the only preventive measure government has taken, even these industry at this time are severely getting impacted. However, we feel that once we come out from this pandemic kind of situation, these are the industry which will run fast, which will recover the fastest. This includes your agriculture, which because of the good amount of rain and overall kind of support which is being built in is really witnessing a promising scenario. IT services is all standing clear. Pharmaceuticals, though the most of the APIs they are importing are from China, but recently when we were speaking, we heard that close to 14 shipments have been unloaded from China. So because of whatever the kind of foreign policy which our country is running, you would be seeing that India is not making any allegation directly on China as of now with respect to the spread of coronavirus or because of the origin of coronavirus. We have not even suited the country. One of the reason being is we are currently dependent on the API and the raw material and the source of origin for our pharma sector from China. So I believe as a foreign policy, we are going across with that and we are getting the imports. Then telecommunication, which is one industry which I feel is having the lowest effect. Then there are some kind of other industry which can have an opportunity time also, like for example, your online, whatever, which we are doing, but then most of these things runs under startups. So your Baiju's, your online technical courses, your data streaming services, your mobile application services, your delivery services, some of these services are still having the ray of hope and even they are contemplating and they are calculating that this year they can have a positive traction in terms of their business. Largely 30% of our India's GDP is coming from MSME and SME sector. When we talk about MSME and SME sector, this is one sector which will bear the most of the heat. The lockdown has created a kind of situation where their businesses are not at all working. The employees are not paid or either left out or moved across from the industry. And even these kind of industry would struggle post any kind of opportunity when the business will reopen to restart their business because of the crunch of financial resources. However, government is contemplating a package of almost 20,000 odd crore for this sector. But as of now, the kind of relief for the MSME and SME sector is still to come in. Friends, I believe every day we are seeing hundreds of newses, we are reading news channels, we are seeing data on WhatsApp. So I'm not going across with the kind of effect more than this, which we have discussed, which COVID-19 will going to make on the industry. Now we are moving on the positive side. As a chartered accountant or as a facilitators, when we are dealing with a lot of our clients, when we are dealing with our clients, which are maybe an SME or an MSME or a mid-sized corporate or a listed entity or a large corporate, they all will be under stress. They all will be looking to us with a ray of hope that under this scenario, how we can support them in terms of raising finances. So we are going across with our second session where we are suggesting some kind of strategies which can be impacted. I will personally be taking some kind of scenarios where we are dealing with banks and where we are seeing and we are sensing what kind of overall mindset in which they are running the current credit mindset. Since as in financing avenues are concerned, we are going across with venues with the type of opportunity in terms of institutions. So when we are talking about small scale institutions or SMEs, I believe the biggest hope for these kind of institutions for raising finances, bootstrapping and crowdfunding. So I believe this will be the time when a small businessman will go to all of his relatives, his friends, his other peers, and will try to, you know, raise some kind of finances. This might not be a kind of activity which we will be promoting, but definitely to a good businessman, we can always support in terms of raising some kind of ICD as an opportunity. The second biggest hope for any institution across the country is the banking and NBFC and the financial sector. There is government programs, with some government programs which is being launched by the RBI and the other bodies. And then there is some opportunity in terms of raising money via venture capital or via private equity. When we talk about banks and finance, this is one area. So let me just give you a basic understanding. Under COVID, the kind of default which banks are assuming, they are saying that close to 25% of SME and SME loans will slip into default. Close to 6% of the large corporates, which will get into a default scenario. Now, this default could be higher for some specific sectors like tour and travel, aviation, textiles, power, hospitality, real estate. But at the same time, the overall estimates which banks are presuming are very, very high. At the same time, most of the banks have given emphasis to build their retail book, which runs around the personal loans or the business loans or some kind of SME and WCDL kind of loans. Banks and NBFCs are estimating that they can have a default to the range of 5 to 6% in terms of their gross book is concerned. Now, friends, when we talk about 5-6% in a retail segment kind of default or a 25% default opportunity or the kind of scenario in MSME and SME sector, this is quite a high number. Now, in the light of these default or the negative scenario, the banks and the financial institutions, they themselves have become very cautious. There are multiple reasons for it. One of the biggest reason is, as a lenders, you know, all said and done, though this is a very, very personal opinion, but I am always of the view that the kind of choices and the institutions which are available in the retail scenario is in any case are in very few numbers. So when we go for in terms of arranging finances for our clients, the choice or the options of banks and the financial institutions is very, very limited. The current consolidation of banks because of the recapitalization and the kind of policy which RBI and the finance ministry has suggested, I don't suppose in long run this could have very beneficial effects till the time government does not open doors for other banks from international scenario or any other financial institutions to come and create any kind of liquidity position in the market, because the choice of lenders itself is very, very low. So when we divide banks and financial institutions, we see banks as foreign banks, private sector banks, and public sector banks. When we talk about foreign banks, when we talk about any kind of loans to SME, MSME, or maybe a mid-market kind of scenario, the one of the few, or there are only two or three multinational banks which fits clients into their criteria. Now, these banks would be Standard Chartered Bank, there can be Citibank. There is some business which could be carried by DBS and Deutsche Bank. But then largely most of these private sector banks, foreign banks, are very, 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 very conservative. They have their own risk assessment criteria, where their criteria in which most of the clients will be falling in is rating driven. So the minimum rating or the threshold rating which these banks look into is something like A or A plus kind of ratings. So almost 75 or 80% or 85% of the market spills out from these foreign bank scenario. Then the next lenders which comes in the foray is the private sector banks, because of the NBFC crisis which is running post ILFS and then DHFL. Private sector banks are the one who have created maximum impact in the entire country. But the kind of loan book at which most of these private sector banks have stressed is retail. So when it comes to MSME and SME, again, the choices is very, very restricted. Unfortunately, because of the slippage of Yes Bank, because of the kind of trauma in which IndusInd and RBL, both banks are running, again, the choice of lenders is very, very restricted in private sector bank scenario. Then third opportunity comes is public sector banks. Because of the consolidation, now you have very few names. So I remember kind of clients with which we are working for. For example, one of our large corporate, which is running a mandate, which is having a loan book of close to 15,000 crore plus. Now, as in lenders, this guy is having a choice of close to 16, 17 banks, you know, with the largest being maybe State Bank of India and the other banks, including Canara Bank, Indian Bank and all. So when it comes to arranging further borrowing for such a large corporate with SBI lending to the tune of 2,500 crore plus, if you go to a small bank and request for 200, 300 crore, the chances of that bank accepting your proposal are very, very high. At the same time, in terms of the credit benchmark also, with the assessment done by large core banks, there are smaller banks which then normally underwrite it very peacefully. But with the kind of consolidation exercise which has happened, even for this particular client, without disclosing the name, earlier when they were running a consortium of 15,000 crore, they have 16 odd banks. With the consolidation happened, their banks itself, the numbers is reduced from 16 to 11. Now with the latest new consolidation which is announced, it will be further reducing to 9 odd banks. With 9 banks and with each of the bank running loan book to the extent of 1500 crore, 2000 crore, because earlier maybe one bank is having a stake of 500 crore, another bank is having a stake of 300 crore, but then both these two banks merged. Now the overall combination in terms of their exposure to the client is 800 crore, which becomes very large. So there is no choice which is available. So when we talk about the consolidation, again, this becomes a very negative scenario for a lot of large borrowers as well as smaller borrowers. NBFCs, we already know the kind of pain which these NBFCs are going from is very, 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 very panic situation. A lot of NBFCs themselves are struggling for their own liquidity position. In also, largely in India, NBFCs were working around very selective products. So most of the NBFCs are either into retail product, which are maybe high yield product, maybe a high yield personal loan or business loan, or maybe a loan against property or a housing loan. And at the same time, they are doing some kind of structured debt or real estate large ticket loans. Again, the scenario is not being very positive for NBFC. Coming back to COVID, why I was running across with all the lending options is we were running in a situation when we were thinking that 1920 was in subtle year. But around last quarter of 1920 financial year, we were all contemplating, we were all thinking, and we were all of the mindset that now scenario will change. Things are turning positive. Even government has done whatever the kind of changes or kind of, you know, the implications which they have to brought it, they have brought in. So overall, after all the consolidation exercise of banks, everything, 2021 and going forward will going to be new year. But this coronavirus has come from sudden. The kind of impact this coronavirus has brought in, the banks have themselves gone into a cautious mode. Again, without disclosing the names of the banks, while I was speaking to some of the senior guys in credit and the business of a couple of banks, and while I was talking to one of the SDM in a public sector bank, they were of the view that as on the mandate is concerned, we've been clearly told that this is 2021 as a financial year. Even if we don't grow our books, the management is okay. Now, with these kind of thoughts, the kind of credit awareness or the kind of credit offtake will in any case going to be low. However, RBI has come out with some special window, which we should be aware, because this is a special opportunity where we should go and pitch to our clients about those kind of opportunities, because most of the clients might not be aware or might be aware, but they don't know the scenario and they don't know the overall opportunity in which they can apply to these kind of institutions. Very suddenly, RBI has also come down and announced few new packages, which includes your TLTRO schemes, which includes your package for RRBs, HFCs, NHBs, wherein for the purpose of the onward lending, they are now pushing other institutions to lend. However, in the current scenario, when banks are not assessing your credit requirements with a very, very positive view, I believe these new products which are launched by the banks comes to a great opportunity. One of the institutions which we were otherwise talking about is venture capital and private equity funds. So any company which is having an investor base, which is having the product which normally looks to be, you know, processable or advisable or acceptable to equity players, I believe this is good time when promoter should say that this is difficult time, instead of raising more debt or instead of increasing cost of interest or going across to raise more debt to, you know, create my business or run my business, it's an opportunity time. I believe we should advise the promoters that they can shell out some share of their equity and raise private equity, take some kind of equity investors on board. This will have double impact. First, their overall equity base will increase. An entry of an established equity player in the balance sheet always gives the base and the solidarity to the existing set of investors, to the existing set of promoters also. And with this kind of strong base, then further any kind of leverage, if any institution wants to take, will also becomes easier. When we compare these different options which are there, government schemes I'm running through. Just after this comparison, we will be going across with some of the products which are newly being launched. But otherwise, bootstrapping and crowdfunding, normally we get it for smaller period. The availability is easy, but then this is normally being brokered by the borrowers itself. The cost will vary. If we go to some friends and all, I believe they can charge us very few kind of interest. When we talk about venture capital and private equity, this is more about understanding the valuation of the entity. However, here the investment time frame is large. There is no principal repayment or interest repayment kind of obligations which any institution will going to have. So this is, I believe, in the current time will going to be a wonderful opportunity. Any of our client where we feel there is an opportunity that there can be institutions who look forward for investing in that company as an equity or private equity or as a venture capitalist, we should promote that. Government schemes we will be just running after this, and banks and NBFCs, the kind of fund size is available. Investment time frame is again going to be available. The pricing is very, very low. So this is one thing which is attractive with whatever has happened in the overall financial scenario. The kind of deposits which is there with the banks is huge. RBI has already facilitated the kind of rates in terms of giving out their own share of cost and everything. So the current pricing which is available for any justified borrower is amazing. Just to give an highlight, we by March 2020 only, anything around 8.5% to 9.5% for average triple B plus kind of borrower or even an A minus kind of borrower is considered to be an appropriate interest rate. However, we will be seeing these interest rates going to almost 0.5% to 1% lower than what we were expecting earlier. So I believe in the time to come, we will be having sufficient capital at pricing which is going to be attractive to the tune of almost 7.5% to 8.5% for all eligible kind of candidates. The various Government of India initiatives under COVID which government has taken, there are few institutions. So there is RBI, then RBI has opened a window for SIDBI, NHB, NABARD. We will be running across with them. The one of the first scheme or one of the first cash flow comfort which government has announced, which RBI has brought down, is for the period of March to May, that is for 3 months period. RBI has come down with a special window where they have instructed banks to allow deferment of interest or principal or EMI to their clients. Now, as a finance expert, definitely we can always go in for a lot of debate about this, but I don't find this as a very, very appropriate step announced by government. However, in current time when we are seeing cash is king, preserving whatever and managing your cash flow to best of your effort, this is one of the effective step which a borrower can take. So RBI has announced that you have to just speak to your bankers. If you are running a term loan, then entire installment which includes your principal as well as interest if you are running a working capital facility like CC and OD, your interest outlay that will not be charged for 2 months to 3 months, but this is a specific request which every borrower has to make to their banks. Once their request is accepted, then they need not to pay anything for 2 months or 3 months kind of window. And then overall, even because this is a special window which is being announced by RBI only, this will not impact your any kind of default or any kind of slippage into NPA or SMA kind of segment also. For CC and OD, it's a different animal. I'm not sure most of the people might be aware, might not be aware. So when we are talking about term loans, if you are getting a deferment for maybe a 2 months or a 3 months installment, whatever the money which is falling due for those 2 months, 3 months, including your principal as well as the interest component, banks, institutions are capitalizing that much money and adding back to your principal. So ultimately your loan tenure is getting extended. So maybe you are running a loan for 60 months. You have not paid installments for 3 months now. So your effective tenure may go to almost 66 or 68 or 69 months, depending on the kind of interest cost and the parameter. But definitely not paying 3 months EMI overall in long-term effect, it will result to an increase of 6 to 12 months kind of EMIs. However, for OD and CC, the kind of effect is pretty different. For OD and CC, banks have instructed that anybody who is having a CC limit which is utilized maybe to the tune of, so for example, let's give an example, somebody is running a CC limit of 20 crore at 10% interest, he's being charged 2 crore rupees interest on 100% utilization, which is divided over a period of months. So every month he has an interest outlay, which he's normally getting debited from your CC account. Here in this current scenario of rescheduling of payments, the interest will not be debited from your CC account for 3 months or 2 months, whatever you have opted for. But on the very next month, soon after this period get over, unfortunately, if government does not extend this moratorium period further, then this entire interest will be debited. I feel a lot of clients will fall into a liquidity trap because as of now, already their CC limit might be utilized to an extent, adding back 3 months interest for which they might not be having money. So soon after 3 months, they have to bring that much kind of interest money from their own pocket for the purpose of serving their CC interest. Then this is basically an easing of working capital financing. Since we were talking about this special window of deferment, which is allowed, so your SMA and NPA slippage will not be effective for these 3 months, 2 months period. There is one specific instruction which has also been given by RBI to banks that for the purpose of calculation of working capital finance, normally the way we calculate drawing power, so they have given specific instructions to bank to be lenient in terms of understanding the margins and calculating the drawing power. However, this will ultimately fall to the policy of each and every bank. RBI is also allowed a refinancing facility to various AIFs. So RBI has come down with a 50,000 crore of special package where they have given almost 25,000 crore to NABARD, 15,000 crore to SIDBI and 10,000 crore to NHB for onward lending. This onward lending ultimately will going to ease the kind of borrowing opportunity for end users from the ultimate institute. Like for example, RRBs, they normally serve your agri clients, your rural commodity clients and all those things. So this is a special window which RBI has brought in to support these special institutions. NBFC loans to commercial estate projects, normally any kind of real estate projects or any kind of commercial projects, normally you have a stipulation of maintaining the deadline, which typically we say COD. So RBI has specifically come down and said that NBFC who has extended any kind of real estate project can extend the COD. By virtue of this, ultimately your loan account will not be falling into NPA, so the provisioning effect will be lower. So NBFCs might have better money in terms of their own jurisdiction. This TLTRO 2.0, which is announced, is again a special product which has been brought by RBI, wherein they said that almost 50,000 crore kind of money they made available to various banks, wherein they are saying at least 50% of this fund, they should onward invest in other lenders with minimum investment grid kind of ratings. This is a special window wherein they are allowing this kind of onward lending against term loans or against treasury kind of product. So any onward lender with a minimum rating of BBB- can come and approach any of these existing banks under TLTRO scheme, and banks will be readily available. Rather, this is a window which has come for a 1 month period only. So within this 1 month only, bank have to invest or lend this kind of money in various NBFCs and other microfinance companies and other HFCs. So any of your borrowers or any of your clients which are into this kind of sector, I believe TLTRO is going to be a wonderful opportunity for them. Vibha, this is one of the only credit product. Hello.
Yeah, Vibha. Hello. There was a question from one of our attendee, specifically with respect to this NBFC onward lending. Can you please go on previous screen?
Just 1 second. Yes.
So this TLTRO, so where government has announced 50,000 crore to all India financial institution for onward lending. So now the government has put an threshold for at least having minimum investment grade for the purpose of acquiring this loan for NBFCs. Those NBFCs, yes. See, we can see in the market, even before COVID-19, some of the NBFCs were, you know, facing too much fight. They were confronting against the customer credit quality. So most of the NBFC to auto financing, NBFC who's into unsecured lending, NBFC who which are into home.
This is not a loan product. This is an investment product. So basically, under TLTRO, the lending will be carried by the treasury team of banks. So normally a treasury team of a bank parks money against NCDs, ICDs, CPs, which are issued by NBFCs. You know, NBFC with a rating of BBB+ or even an A- rating can issue a 100 crore NCD. And they can take down this NCD instruments to banks, which ultimately can subscribe to their NCD. So the credit question, quality norms in respect of their book.
So my question is with respect to that only. Normally NBFCs are rated by their, you know, portfolio quality, and most of the NBFC would not be having. Would not be having, you know, investment grade nowadays, and specifically even after COVID-19, no one will have. So how this will, you know, give a boost to our economy? How the NBFC will get a, you know, a special liquidity through this window?
See, ultimately, this is an onward lending mechanism where RBI is allowing banks to park their extra money or their treasury money with NBFCs. The minimum stipulation today for any bank or any institution for this TLTRO scheme is investment grade. And I believe anything below investment grade will ultimately hamper the credit quality check for most of these banks. So any NBFC which is not even having a BBB- kind of rating will not fall into for this kind of product. And in current scenario, I don't suppose NBFCs with rating less than investment grade can have any kind of fundraising opportunity also. So they should go for raising money from promoter only, or they should add on more investors on their board who can bring in equity kind of money. But getting debt or smaller kind of coupons or any kind of debts from further NBFCs and all, in any case, has become very, very low. So earlier you would be knowing that there were a lot of IFMR, Reliance, Tata, Aditya Birla. They themselves were NBFCs, but they were ultimately onward lending to further NBFCs against their loan book, and they are creating term loans to smaller NBFCs. But with the dried up scenario after ILFS and DHFL, most of the onward lending by NBFCs has stopped. So today the only lenders for NBFCs is most of these banks and financial institutions only, for which minimum criteria is investment grade.
Means only the big NBFC who are backed by good
it's
funds,
not
good
necessary
capital.
Big NBFC. So we know NBFCs with even 200 crore kind of loan book having ratings to the tune of BBB+ and all. So they are all eligible. It's not to do with the book. It's not like the minimum threshold book of this NBFC or microfinance company should be 500 crore, 1000 crore or 5000 crore or whatever. So even with a 100 crore kind of book, but the rating should be minimum BBB- or plus.
Okay. So very few NBFCs are going to get benefit of this.
I believe reasonably the known NBFCs, which are there in the lending business, whatever the name you can think of, they will be falling into it. But any small door-to-door kind of NBFC, which are there prevalent in, you know, otherwise financial markets, they might not be coming into this kind of ambit. I feel that's fine with you, na, Manoj?
Yeah, that's fine.
Hello. Friends, now one of the most interesting product, I believe, which any chartered accountant should take to their clients is this emergency credit line. This is an interesting product which is launched by RBI. Most of the public sector banks, rather all the public sector banks, have created product around this product. So what the product guidelines which I am sharing with you is of SBI, but then similarly Union Bank has also come and created their own product line. Bank of Maharashtra has also created their own product line. Indian Bank has also created their own product line, like that. Under emergency credit line, this is a COVID-19 emergency credit line of credit. This is like an ad hoc limit. So under this ad hoc limit, banks are sanctioning up to 10% of borrowers' existing fund-based working capital limit as an ad hoc limit. So for example, you have a borrower which is running an working capital fund-based facility of 20 crore with your bank, you can immediately go and approach State Bank of India or other banks as per the criteria and can ask for an ECL ad hoc limit, which is 10% of your existing. This funds is available at most cheap rate, like SBI has come down with a 7.25% fixed rate. They are also giving moratorium for non-repayment up to the extent of 6 months. The repayment of this ad hoc limit is also spread up to 2 years. So this is one of a wonderful facility which is launched by banks. Another bigger part is that there is no security or collateral which is asked for this ad hoc kind of limits. The only thing which whatever the current assets on which charge was already there by the bank, you have to extend that charge. Whatever the guarantee and collateral security which earlier has been given in the existing working capital facility, you have to extend charge for the ad hoc limit on that existing collateral only. This ad hoc limit is in additional to other ad hoc limit schemes which were announced by banks. Like for example, you remember that there is an SME assist and then a special ad hoc limit has come against GST input credit. So all those ad hoc limits can be over and above. However, the entire ad hoc limits which a client would have availed should not be more than 25% of the fund-based working capital which a client has availed. So up to 10%, this is the cheapest and the easiest kind of borrowing which we can raise for our client. The rates are amazing. There is no processing fees. There is no security which you need to give. And banks are also instructed to approve these kind of borrowing within a span of 7 to 10 days. So once you go to your existing banker for your client and you say that I need this ad hoc limit, within 7 to 10 days, this limit will be approved. There is no criteria of calculating any DP, nothing. So this is one of the easiest product which has come in the market. Only constraint is that by mid of March, like this special window product which is being launched. So till by mid of March, something like by 26 March or 16th March, the account should not have fallen in SMA or SMA2. So if a borrower is having a standard facility with the bank and if he need any kind of special window, he can simply go and approach his existing banker. Even SIDBI has launched a product which is 50 lakhs loan for MSMEs, but this has come within specific noble cause. So any of your client or anyone who is dealing into manufacturing medical supplies or any kind of products under sanitizers, masks, gloves and all. So for them, this 50 lakh loan will be available. This is again a collateral free loan, but the rate of interest is very attractive. This is coming for 5% interest rate. The loan tenure which is coming, this is there for almost a 2 year kind of scenario. So this is again a wonderful product which is launched by SIDBI. There is a SIDBI COVID-19 startup assistance scheme also. Now here SIDBI has come down with a 2 crore loan, but then the borrower need to be startup. So when we say startup means it should be a defined startup as per the definition criteria of Startup India Foundation, there should be an existing investor also within this startup. So this startup should have raised some capital from some AIF earlier. And this 2 crore loan is available wherein he can make the repayment in 24 months. There is a turnover criteria for this, that the turnover should be between 10 crore to 60 crore. Friends, this is all which is there in terms of special window is concerned. Maybe we can take question and answers and we can move forward in terms of explaining any further thoughts which any of our participants is having.
Thanks a lot, Vaibhav, for your suggestions. So we got questions from some of the attendees over here. So the next question, my first question would be pertaining to bankers' mindset. Means after this COVID-19, as you said in your presentation also, SMEs, MSME, they are contributing 30% towards our GDP. So after COVID-19, how bankers' mindsets are going to get changed? Because all SMEs, small corporates, they are not going to meet bankers' criteria. Definitely, bankers are going to strengthen their credit policy. So how the bankers are going to fuel in the economy? Banker works as a window for distributing the supply of money. Means like they are managing the credit flows. How means stringent or how lenient they would be as far as lending is concerned? And if they are flexible, who are going to take part on the losses if it occurs on account of flexible lending? And if they are stringent, how economy is going to, you know, get fueled in? So that's the question on mindset of bankers.
Manoj, as in the mindset of most of the bankers with which we are dealing in, talking to on daily basis and all, the mindset is really negative. The most of the risk guys, credit guys who are currently appraising any kind of new loan applications or any kind of new clients requirements, you know, they are very concerned with the effect which ultimately coronavirus will going to have in terms of their own business flow. So you know that today we are running in a lockdown kind of scenario. It's a practical understanding that whenever any business falls in lockdown, to reopen again, to reinitialize the business relationships again, to reflow the kind of supply chain machinery which they have built in, and to create the kind of payment window which is normally there within their own creditors and debtors, it takes time. During the slippage time, the numbers will definitely going to fall. So an existing client with a turnover of 100 crore, you know, on a basic working capital calculation, maybe if he's running a working capital of 30 odd crore, and if in the current scenario his turnover is falling from 100 crore to 70 crore, you know, or maybe 60 crore or 50 crore, whatever, then even his existing DP calculations will not going to fit in. With whatever the relaxed norms also, even if banks continue his existing working capital limits, I believe that itself is a boon. But from an existing banker to look forward for an additional limit will be tough. However, there can be opportunity for new banks to be brought in, wherein a client or a customer has to brought in some more credit security, whether a support in terms of the collateral security, whether a support in terms of some kind of fixed cash flow which he can hypothecate, or maybe the net worth position or the personal guarantee of the promoters wherein their overall borrowing is very, very limited. So these could be the scenario. Otherwise, it will going to be very watchful time. And I believe in another 3 to 6 months, we have to go with this kind of mindset only. So the kind of expectations or the cash flow modeling which we are doing for our clients, we need to be in control with our understanding about the financial market.
Thanks, Vaibhav. You already covered one of my other question. I was about to asking how the credit policy is going to be more strict. So you covered that net worth, security control, cash flow, and we are going to escrow more. So my next question would be pertaining to the people, the guy who are in our debt syndication. As you are into debt syndication, I'm into debt syndication since last 7-8 years. I've also played some of the crucial roles in raising funds for some SMEs, MSME, mid-corporates. So Vaibhav, how is our role is going to be after, once the lockdown lifts up, once the normality level comes? How do you see, means how our role is going to be more prominent, and
But rather today, I feel as in syndicators or as an investment bankers, our role will be very, very strong. Because now, you know, when market was running green, when everything is hunky-dory, you don't really need consultants. Even with a grimmer balance sheet, when banks themselves wants to be in a shoe where they have, you know, targets, and when they want to expand their credit book, the borrowing or the kind of fundraising was not challenging. Today, I believe as a syndicator or as a consultant or as a chartered accountant, our role will become very important, because we are the one who can assess the actual financial requirements of the clients. We are the one who understands the financial strength of our client, and we are the one who will going to go and present our client to any of these lenders and talking about the specific positives or the opportunities which we can focus for our client. See, this is the time when there will be a difference between, you know, we always say that jab market acha chal raha hota hai to ghade ghode sab daud rahe hote hain. But now this will be the time when a specific professional with the kind of mindset and understanding can make difference for their client. And I believe even bankers will be very happy to deal with professionals who brings positive clients, who brings merits of their clients, and who will be in position to talk better about their client rather than dealing with someone who is not professional.
Okay. Well, this COVID-19 is definitely going to, you know, it's going to impact a lot of industries. Some of the green shoe industry, as we can say, pharmaceuticals, healthcare, infra, telecom, technical integrated solution service provider, and some of the industry which are going to have a negative impact, like we can say aviation, hotel industries, some other industry like real estate, commercial, residential real estate. So how it would be, as far as the impact is concerned, so how it would be easy for the industries who are going to have a positive impact, whether they would be able to raise fund just after the you know, normality level comes. And so, as far as negative industries is concerned, how difficult it would be for them to raise finance from banks or institution, because they are going to have a negative impact to in the eyes of the lenders. So, and if the negativity level continues, how long they would not be able to raise finance? 6 months, 12 months, or so on. So what's your view on that?
So Manoj, today is the time when we have to really highlight clients with positive traction. So industries like pharma, industries like hospital, your hospitals, industries like education, online studies and all, you know, these guys will going to have a good balance sheet. These are the guys who will going to have a decent numbers to their credit. And these are the clients which, for which even the lenders will be more than interested, because when you talk to any lenders today, even public sector banks, they have got studies and groups divided as per industry. So they have industry experts in their own core team. And as an industry scenario is concerned, they always take a view of these product guys who highlight that whether this industry is on positive traction or negative traction. So any industry which is on positive traction, there will be an opportunity time for those borrowers. Also for negative industries, you know, the industries which are running tough times, I believe, like, for example, real estate. For real estate, close to 4.5 months back, 4 months back, RBI and government has come down and opened up a special product and special window called Swayam Fund. Now, this Swayam Fund was incorporated by LIC Housing and SBI as in core, you know, fund originators for this kind of borrowing. So they have contributed close to 10,000 crore. This one fund, which is managed by SBI Venture Fund, which is headed by Mr. Irfan Kazi, who is the CIO, is one of the leading investor today in real estate sector. They already have sanctioned close to 6-7 cases in last 2 months. So even under Corona, they are doing disbursements, they are sanctioning transactions, and they are moving across with the client's requirement. So from an arranger's perspective, from an investment banker's perspective, I believe the key is to identify the room and the opportunity and the kind of special window which government has brought in. So if we work within the framework of that window, there will be a success. Just like real estate, so if we normally go and talk to any other institution, they will say, no, we will not be lending under real estate because this is a negative industry. the impact will be bad, there will be no sales, the construction is halted. But within this special product which is launched by SBI, if we go and showcase our transaction or the client's requirement, they will be more than happy to look into that kind of transaction. So as an arranger investment banker, we need to segregate positive and negative industry. For positive industry, definitely everybody is welcoming. But for negative industry, we need to identify special windows, which ultimately government will going to brought in. And we have to pitch the transactions into that special window only.
Thanks, Vaibhav. And especially for this new Swayan fund, at least this real estate sector is going to get some relief. 10,000 crore rupees of corporate, it's a big amount. But
so overall again, fund which is available to their discretion is 25,000 crore. And fortunately, okay, this fund is not even, you know, normally whenever any AIF or any funds were there, they were all talking about top six cities of the country. This fund is looking forward for funding even in a CAD D kind of city. So like, even you are sitting today in Bhilwara because of, so even a city like Bhilwara having a real estate project would fall in the swine. They don't have any negative criteria for that.
So at least it will provide some relief to those real estate developers. And
yes,
you know,
definitely.
It will really work. So everyone has to, you know, go through all the eligibility condition, and we need to look on how, which kind of project suits fit for this product. Vaibhav, my next question would be from the point of view of alternate tech lending platforms. As we can see, tech lending platform, they works as an intermediary between, you know, people who has finance and people who need finance. So they are working on the product generally like bill discounting, lease rental discounting and other products. So how do you see the prospects and feasibility of alternate tech solution platform? Because the cost of fund of this platform is pretty much on a higher side. So are they going to get the same kind of Are they going to get same kind of business or any downfall may be expected?
No. So these funds are like hawks, you know, and they always have an eye on wonderful opportunity wherein they can pick this kind of scenario. So today, a stress kind of position with a good opportunity company. So a company which because of the market position and all is not running in a good position. I believe these alternate institutes look forward for those opportunities. There are multiple funds which are available, which fund either as pure debt or as an hybrid between debt and equity or as in pure equity kind of investment. But normally the IRR expectation for most of these funds are higher. It normally ranges from anything around 14 to 15% plus. But I believe a lot of these funds like Cerebras has come, Apex has come. So a lot of these people have come in already in India. SSG is already investing a lot of money. So there is a number of these high opportunity and alternate investments funds which are now coming in India. And they are finding it alternatively a wonderful time to invest.
Thanks, Vaibhav. Vaibhav, you are able to see my screen? Is it visible?
I cannot see you, but I believe we are all audible, so it's convenient.
Okay, we are audible. Okay. So definitely, I would request all the attendees to post their question as well, because so we can have some questions from your side. And you know, we can take the maximum question which is possible in view of the time availability. So Vaibhav, my next question it would be pertaining to, you know, government and RBI's reliefs. As RBI and government, they have, you know, adopted very much calibrated and granular approach for providing some liquidity boost or providing some financial support to the system. RBI has come up in the early part of this month, they have come up with you know, a reduction in CRR, reduction in MSF, extending moratorium, as you also mentioned in your presentation. And the day before yesterday, 50,000 crore rupees package to MF, and I think yesterday also they have announced some 3 trillion rupees guarantee proposal for all the loan being extended to small loan. However, that was also, you know, limited up to 20% of the existing facility. However, but this also gives a kind of, you know, assurance to bankers for extending the loan to small banks. So what do you think, being an India $2.7 trillion dollar economy, we stands as the fifth rank in the economy as far as GDP is concerned, these kind of supports are enough, or we can expect some more relief from RBI and the government, which can enable bank to lend further and you know, provide the more credit flows to the economy? So some more reliefs are expected, or this is the enough which will bring the normality?
I feel definitely because if we compare globally the kind of relief which central banks have announced in comparison to the country's GDP, India is way low. So the current government has announced GDP, the kind of relief package, with the initial package was close to 0.5% of the GDP. Adding on the second package, I believe it comes to almost 0.8-0.9% of the package, the GDP of India. So looking into, in contrast to the other countries, if we look into, there is definitely a lot of window which government will be announcing.
Okay. Webber, people are also afraid of, you know, means, see, this COVID-19 has created too much commotion between, you know, businessmen and the salaried guys. Salaried guys are running for their survival because too much job threats or job losses threats are there, salary cuts are there, and businessmen are, you know, they much worried for running their show, their business organizations. They have their fixed administration operating costs which they need to offer upon. So once this lockdown lifts up, there is some sound on the back. Hello? Virag?
Yeah.
Hello?
Hello, I can hear you.
There's some what happened?
No, there was some disturbance, so I thought, okay. So, Webber, so I was asking ki, with respect to that, how do you foresee the situation, whether the businessman or salaried guy should immediately, once the normality level comes, should run for availing the loan facility, the special facility like ECL, like COVID-19 special loans? They should run, or they should sit, keep quiet, observe the market, observe the economy very closely, and then after observance, they try to act accordingly. What they need to do in this tough time?
I feel in the current time, any kind of new borrowing, if somebody is eyeing for, is basically for the survival or for the purpose of ongoing businesses only. Any kind of additional borrowing or any kind of extravaganza kind of borrowing should be completely avoided. At the same time, the kind of business operations, people should wait and watch. They should look forward for window to open. They should look forward for market to open. And basis the requirement only, they should look forward for availing any kind of loans.
ओके सो उनको इकोनॉमी को पूरा ऑब्जर्व करना है, कैसे उनके सप्लायर, कैसे उनके कस्टमर, कैसे कंजम्पशन पैटर्न बिहेव कर रहा है, और उसी अकॉर्डिंगली एक्ट करना है, राइट?
यस.
एनी क्वेश्चन विराग, यू कैन यू सी एनी क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम अटेंडी साइड? हेलो.
No, I can see a few questions. I believe, yeah, I can see a few questions. So one Mr. Rajkumar Agarwal has mentioned one question. Sir, please elaborate a recent RBI circular for NBFC, whether this NBFC will certainly get this fund from bank. This is a time-bound disbursement and with penalty clause. Actually, I believe I have covered it into TLTRO scheme, but again, I'm giving a reply to it. Under TLTRO scheme, which government has announced, there is a window of almost 50,000 crore. This is definitely a time-barred window. So up to, I believe, 30th of June, any borrower has to avail this facility from the respective banks, because this is a 3 months window for which this funds would be made available by RBI. And NBFCs can borrow within the parameter of this TLTRO. This is a low-cost funding, and this funding is available for minimum investment grade kind of NBFCs. Rajiv Madanji has asked, since most of the sectors have negative outlook, what will be the position of rating agencies on keeping the rating intact? Rating agencies, sir, post your ILFS kind of scenario has already become very tight. So they are not taking any risk, and they are diluting the ratings, or they are already taking very negative outlook towards all the businesses. So I don't suppose rating agencies will keep anything holding with them. They will immediately downgrade the rating or downgrade the outlook. What about at the time of renewal of bank limit due to low visibility of business, how will bank do the appraisal? Rajiv Madanji has asked another question, that at the time of renewal of bank limit due to low visibility of business, how will bank do the appraisal? So RBI has already instructed banks to take a, you know, friendly and a, you know, more lenient approach in terms of DP calculation. However, they at the same time instructed banks that this is their fitting to their own policy. So I believe here it will purely depends upon the relationship of the borrower and the lender, how convincingly you can speak to your bankers about the DP calculation and all. However, RBI has definitely given a specific instructions to bank to go easy in terms of doing these appraisals. Virag,
your screen is not appearing.
Manoj, I'm seeing there are a lot of questions which are now coming in. As we are running already short of time, because we've been instructed that we have to close this by 5:30. Already 5:15 is there. And then I believe the organizers also wants to do a concluding note and all. Maybe we can have these questions coming to us on mail, and we can definitely reply to each and every question which is being asked. Tarachanji Bafna is there from the organizer side, I believe. Tarachanji, I believe that will go good with organizers also.
Yes, Vibha, but I think in view of the time availability, we have still 15 minutes. So one or two questions more we can take up. Hello.
Just one second.
So the next question was, what prospects would the techno financial consultant have for services to lenders and their clients?
So the entire benchmark for doing PV studies have changed. I believe this is the time when we have to again create new benchmark for any of the business proposal or any of the project proposal which we are making. The kind of supply from the raw material perspective, the kind of markets, like for example, for a lot of industry, when you are exporting your goods to markets like Europe and US, there will be a lot of restrictions for your shipments to be going there. There will be issues in terms of logistics and transportation. So the benchmark will be different. However, the basic benchmark will always going to be there in the same scenario. This in any case going to be a temporary phase. So TV consultants can prepare report sounding maybe 5-10% negative with the earlier expectations or assumptions which they normally were making.
The next question is, since most of the sector have negative outlook, so what will be the position of rating agency on keeping the rating intact as this COVID, so most of industrial disruption and economical disruption we can see, are these rating agencies are going to be conservative or they are?
We have already taken this question. Yeah. Abhishek, we cannot hear you.
Can we take last question now?
Yeah.
See, the collateral security question. See, most of the collateral security will have a downward revision post COVID-19. So whether the bank is going to ask for additional collateral, or they going to, you know, adjust for the existing collateral and trying to readjust the facility?
The banks are not the technical expert to understand valuation of collateral. They will ultimately be referring for revaluation from valuers only, registered valuers and all. So it will purely depends. However, in the current market scenario, I believe valuations can come 5, 10, 15% lower than the last valuation which they have given. So again, this is a very technical requirement. Again, most of these scenario, it will purely go with the relationship between lenders and the borrowers, because there is no stipulated criteria. You know, RBI or any bank's credit policy, they does not announce that minimum this kind of security need to be taken. This is a risk parameter. So it purely goes with the risk assessment of the bank. If they feel it is worth going across with the current security, they will continue with even the lower security. However, if they feel that there is high risk involved in that, they might ask for additional security.
Abhishek, anything from your side? Virag, anything from your side? Any questions and all?
No. So we are closing. Yeah. So, Manoj bhai.
We can just launch a quick poll regarding the webinar feedback. So all are requested to kindly vote for this quick poll.
All the viewers and attendees, they would be seeing this blue screen on the laptop
poll, yeah.
Overall,
yeah, there is a poll is going on, so people are filling that poll.
And would like to request participants that we are coming up with more and more interesting topics for the webinar and itself also webinar series. We are launching RERA from tomorrow, Ind AS from 1st May, Ind AS series, much awaited, many have requested us. And tomorrow also, same time, 4 o'clock, we have a wonderful session on ABCD, new ABCD of our CA profession. So we are covering technology aspect as well in this tomorrow's topic. So kindly do join us tomorrow also at 4 o'clock. Hope you all got the mail and other information. If you not got, kindly contact me or Abhishek, we'll provide the same.
Virag, for the purpose of panelist, if we want the presentation to be shared, we can mail that as well.
Yeah, please. We have made a WhatsApp group as well for this webinar. We will share them. And we'll also share to
Just add me in that WhatsApp group. I will.
For any webinar, we will add the speaker also for any query solving also and presentation or other material to be shared with the participants. We'll add immediately.
So,
down the line, any participants have anything, they can post their question.
We can take a question right away. In case if anybody is missed, they can take in on WhatsApp also. So if anybody is not in the WhatsApp group, kindly go to your mail and you will find the link also. Or contact me on my mobile number. Kindly note my mobile number 7043-154-500. 7043-154-500.
Virag, I think your mobile number needs no introduction because in all of the message your mobile number is mentioned. So
yes.
And most of the attendees, I think 100% of the attendees having your number.
Right.
Yeah. So Virag, can we summarize it up or can we give a thank note or anything from your side? Tarachanji, anything from your side?
सर आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है
आई थिंक तारा जी इन दी ऑन म्यूट ओनली वी कैन नॉट हियर हिम सो अभिषेक यू प्लीज टेक ओवर
सर आपकी आवाज नहीं इनको म्यूट तो नहीं कर रखा है सो सो ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ सीएस ऑफ मुंबई व्हाट नेक्स्ट टीम सो वी वुड लाइक टू से स्पेशल थैंक्स टू वैभव सर मनोज जी ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ मी एंड विराग एंड आई वुड से दैट यू हैव शेयर्ड अ लॉट्स ऑफ थिंग व्हिच इज रियली गुड एंड we should implement that and I really thankful to you both because you have given your around 2 hours in this special lockdown period you have spent that much time to our network and that is really good so thank you on behalf of CAs of Mumbai and what next thing. And I want to thanks to TC Bafna sir also, because who also spent 2 hours with us. So thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Hello.
Yes, Manoj, please continue.
Thanks a lot, Virag. Thanks a lot, Vaibhavji, Abhishekji, Tarachanji, and all the attendees. I think we got a good, knowledge points, and we are definitely going to get benefited by the enriching experience being shared by Vaibhavji. Definitely, banks have their negative outlooks, and industry is going to get a hard hit. So we need to act very carefully. Watch the economy, observe the economy, need to act accordingly. So we are definitely going to have benefited from this session, and I would like to thanks Vaibhav and thanks all the organizers of this webinar.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Bye bye.
Special thanks to all attendees. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you.